Here's the recipe. Grow yourself around 800,000 free-range organic brain cells. A mix of human and mouse is fine. Then drop them into a dish wired with around 1,000 electrodes and plug it all into the classic video game Pong.
Great Scott.
Then fire electrical impulses into your dish brain to tell it where the ball is.
If we saw that they were able to learn, it would suggest that cells are actually trying to engage in this sort of behaviour at a very fundamental level. And that's actually what we saw, which was hugely exciting.
And if you've done it right, congrats. You've got yourself a homegrown Pong champion.
We are the champions.
The next step for Brett's unholy creation, beer pong. No, seriously.
We're going to see, how does alcohol affect the performance of these cells?
Dish brain is just like us.
But there is an actual point to all this.
If we can do it to test, let's say, how toxins or alcohol affect how these cells process information, we could look at different treatments for diseases, we can explore different drugs and how they affect the cells.
And beyond that, things could get really wild. Dish brain's only about as smart as a bumblebee, but it's a fast learner. Even faster than the most advanced AI.
Are you thinking one? I'm thinking B1.
I think I am B2.
It's cyber time.
We don't really think that's the right way that we want to look at it. What it can also be thought of is as an amazing new biomaterial that is able to engage intelligently with its environment. Robotics could be an enormous application for this sort of work.
Amazing! Luckily, there are no cautionary tales or ethical issues whatsoever around this sort of thing.
Will these so-called mini-brains develop to the point where they can feel pleasure or pain? How might we consider their moral status if they were conscious?
It's alive! Kiara Bergerman is a nanoengineer and is taking a keen interest in this breakthrough. Kiara, great to see you. This seems like a big deal, is it?
I think it is. I think It's not necessarily a big deal that we've taught something to play Pong, but to do it in a Petri dish, that's what's really cool.
In terms of the research that you do, what does a dish brain playing Pong mean? How does that change anything in your pursuits?
Well, it gives us something that we can study. Finding cures, finding better medicine often depends on finding a model of the disease that we can study or a model of the organ that we can use. So if we have this functional learning brain on a chip, then we can compare that to situations when the brain isn't functioning as well as it should and try to figure out ways to fix them.
So, Kiara, which corner of the medical and scientific community is most excited about what they can do with this information?
It's going to be a tough fight, really, because you're going to have, on the one hand, the computer scientists, artificial intelligence, neural networks, machine learning. Getting that to function really well and really efficiently will rely on figuring out how human brains work. And then on the other hand, there's all the medical scientists and researchers like me. We absolutely love having that small level detail to work with, because it's very difficult to work on a whole living organism and try to isolate one little thing having a positive or negative effect.
So is there an end game in terms of specific diseases like dementia?
I think it will definitely have applications in dementia. So not necessarily always in terms of getting the brain cells thinking again, but also in terms of promoting new brain cells that we might use to replace damaged brain tissue. That's actually the type of research that I do, where we try to build environments that support and foster young stem cells and encourage them specifically to become functional brain cells. Having these specific electrical cues and stimulus and that back and forth communication that they've shown in this research here, that's an avenue that we can add to our research so that when we try to make new healthy brain tissue, we can make it even better.
In your wildest dreams, where does this get us to?
Ooh, in my wildest dreams, I would like to see more communication between biological systems and computer systems. So research like this connects that computer language that we've got really well developed, we have very advanced computers, into something that the biological system can actually interpret and work with. So that's really cool.
And Kiara, how long before, and be honest please, one of this brain's descendants enslaves the human race, do you think? Ballpark figure.
So I don't think these brains are going to take over the human race. I think we need to keep in mind when we talk about these brains learning, or these brain cells learning how to play Pong, we have lots of animals that can be trained to do things. We even, like, your plants will respond to stimuli. They will grow towards the windows in your house. It's not a matter of building a super brain that will take over the world or become super intelligent and enslave us all or anything. Again, it's the simplicity of this model that's actually great. So being able to train it and to see what's going on at every step.
Kiara, thanks for enlightening us tonight.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.